Before the launch of the James Webb Space Telescope, one question was about what it could do in regards to the search for life in the universe. The long delay in launching the telescope allowed for many years of thinking and speculation on just what it could do in this regard. It wasn't really built for that. Its main mission is to observe in the infrared and help characterize the earliest stars and galaxies in the universe. But as a large aperture space telescope, astrobiology and exoplanet studies were on the table as well. One thing that sets it apart is that it can characterize exoplanet atmospheres within certain constraints, but with a much wider capability than that of Hubble. But there was always a chance that in its observations it might find some kinds of signatures suggesting a biosphere on an exoplanet, especially in regards to already known exoplanets that were already featuring interesting attributes such as the TRAPPIST-1 system. For the most part, this was expected to increase our knowledge of what exoplanet atmospheres might be like by studying when the exoplanets transit their stars. And there we can see how the planet's atmosphere alters the light. As an aside, it was always possible that with JWST we might find something rather unexpected. We know very little about atmospheres beyond the solar system and even a signature of life, but what's unfolding now exceeds those expectations, at least potentially. A very strange exoplanet exists not far from Earth that will not only greatly expand our understanding of exoplanets at large, but may represent an alien biosphere. The planet in question was already known. It's a really large super-Earth, or sometimes called a mini-Neptune, though it's probably nothing like our ice giant Neptune, about 8.6 times more massive than our planet, and about 2.6 times Earth's diameter. Usually this would not be ideal for life. This is a very high gravity planet, but there may be a very special type of exoplanet class that might allow for it, more on that in a bit. Very different from our own very special type of exoplanet. Known as K2-18b, this exoplanet is about 124 light years from Earth in the constellation Leo and orbits a red dwarf. This is in the neighborhood. When the light left that star, it was only the turn of the 19th-20th century, almost within living memory. Interestingly, this exoplanet was discovered by the Kepler spacecraft, the same that discovered KIC-8462-852, or Tabby Star. But as this exoplanet has been studied, some very interesting ideas have been surfacing in the scientific community about this star system, even before the news from JWST. Here is what we know about the host star. The red dwarf K2-18 is a type M3V very cool star. It's significantly smaller and cooler than the Sun, with a radius of about 45% that of the Sun. As astrobiology enthusiasts know, red dwarfs have been a subject of intense debate regarding habitability over the years. They might be good for life if certain hypotheses are true, or they might not, due to their planets tending to be tidally locked in the habitable zone, along with flare activity from the star itself, and so on. So here we simply don't know how good or bad red dwarfs are, but they do make up the most numerous type of star in the universe. This is compounded by some red dwarfs being more active than others. There's a lot of variation there. And we also don't know how they flare. Recent work suggests that they may not flare at their equators, meaning any planets would be safe. In this case, K2-18 is moderately active, but with an unclear star spot profile, which can complicate studying these systems, including giving false detections. There are two known planets in this system, the exoplanet in question, and also another, K2-18c. And the two planets may be tidally interacting with each other, which may turn out key as this story unfolds. Flaring and star spots could complicate observations of these worlds, so there is the first point of caution. The readings can be misleading, and when you look again, you might not see the same thing. The study in this case, however, made two observations, so it's not just based on one sampling. And now to the exoplanet of interest. As mentioned, K2-18b has a mass above 8.6 times that of Earth. Being in the habitable zone of a red dwarf, it orbits very close in to the star, completing its year in just 33 days. This planet is likely to be tidally locked, though there is uncertainty there. The density of the planet shows that it seems to be intermediate between Neptune and Earth, which means it can hold hydrogen better than a planet like Earth, but not perfectly. It will still lose it. If it's rocky and terrestrial, it would be very different from Neptune. But if not, it may be more like Neptune. We don't yet know. But the indications we have right now suggest it's rocky. There's also a chance that it's a pure water planet with a thin atmosphere, but that possibility was never likely and is dropping off the table. The age of this system is younger than the solar system, about 2.4 billion years, with a large uncertainty of several hundred million years. This planet is, however, well within the habitable zone of the star, and under the right conditions could be hosting liquid water. But if an ocean exists, then there is probably a high-pressure layer of forced ice over a rocky core, which could create all kinds of scenarios about how this planet could be convecting heat to its dark side should it be tidally locked. It's really somewhat sketchy as to what the conditions of this exoplanet really are because of uncertainties in what we know. It could marginally be a water world with a thick hydrogen envelope, which might protect it from the red dwarf, incidentally. Or it might be something else. It's walking on several different tightropes and could go either way. Interestingly, with some of these readings, had this exoplanet been a bit smaller, we'd be deeper into potential biosphere territory. But we do know that there is water vapor there, making up about 1% of the atmosphere, give or take 0.5%. Ammonia does not appear. Hydrogen can escape, but at a lesser rate than it would a planet like Earth, but it can also be replenished if water is being broken down by the radiation from the red dwarf. The point is, as another point of caution, there's a ton of uncertainty here, due in no small part to us being at the very beginning of science and research into exoplanet atmospheres. That said, new information from JWST adds a level of weirdness to this exoplanet that could be key, and certainly will be a subject of much debate here on out. New observations show carbon-bearing molecules in the atmosphere. These include methane and carbon dioxide. These are common gases in the universe and do not require life to be present. But what their presence does do is add evidence to a hypothesis that's been floating around for a while of a type of planet that might look like this. It's called a Hycean world, and that's where this gets weird. Hycean is a portmanteau of the words hydrogen and ocean. It's a hot, water-covered planet with a hydrogen atmosphere. This puts them on the table for being habitable. They have liquid water. And it's even been said that these should actually be a common type of exoplanet. None are confirmed, but there are a number of candidates, mostly from the Kepler mission. These planets could be larger than the type of habitable planet Earth is, and in fact are predicted to be up to 10 times Earth's mass. K2-18b fits this. These types of worlds also would have habitable zones larger than that of Earth due to their conditions, if they are indeed habitable. There are also hypothesized dark Hycean exoplanets that are tidally locked, with one side in permanent dark, which may also be the case with K2-18b. But questions of runaway greenhouse effects have to be asked with these worlds. Hydrogen atmospheres are tricky, and they could be too hot for a permanent ocean. But K2-18b was a candidate, again before this research, because it seemed to sit at just the right distance from its star to possibly avoid that and maintain an ocean, and thus be an example of a Hycean world. The lack of ammonia and the presence of water vapor, carbon dioxide, and methane stand to support that K2-18b is a Hycean world. But it's still possible that even if it does have an ocean, it could still be too hot for life. These worlds could look very different from Earth, atmospheres of hydrogen and other gases, an ocean under high mass gravity which might make for very calm seas, over a layer of pressure ice over a rocky core. Not that much like Earth, but in the broader perspective potentially habitable, but by life living under very different conditions than our own. This ocean is also very likely far deeper than Earth's oceans with no land. And that's where the first mystery about this weird exoplanet begins. It's been mentioned since the story broke that carbon dioxide might actually be in disequilibrium in a hydrogen atmosphere, at least in this way. This equilibrium of carbon dioxide in an atmosphere is a potential biosignature. It's not a great one, since carbon dioxide can be produced through many abiotic means, but it does raise an eyebrow. But couple that with another potential detection in the spectrum that found the CO2 and methane. It may have found the chemical dimethyl sulfide. But this detection is not strong in this data. It's actually a 1 sigma detection, which in astronomy, you need 3 sigma for anything meaningful. It needs serious confirmation from other teams, so this is the third point of caution. But if it's there, it has serious implications because it is also a biosignature gas. On Earth, dimethyl sulfide is produced in two ways, life and industry. Upcoming JWST observations will either confirm or disprove the initial detection. But if it's confirmed, this is where this gets really odd, because in that case, not only is K2-18b exhibiting one biosignature, but two separate biosignatures. And both can be technosignatures, but you'd need a radio signal or something to get into that territory as the gases themselves are produced by biology. No doubt this planet has rocketed to the top of the list as far as exoplanets of interest, but it's far too early to get excited. This is not a confirmation of a biosphere on an exoplanet, rather it's merely a possibility. The good news is that the system is slated for more observations with Webb, and no doubt other telescopes, including radio telescopes and SETI. What it does do is validate how powerful JWST is. And that we saw a planet like this so early sort of points to a lot of weird exoplanets yet to be discovered. However, if this is indeed a biosignature world, discovered that close this early, then inhabited worlds must be very, very common in the universe. Indeed, Hycean worlds may outnumber Earths for life. But at higher gravity, everything there is locked in, both because of an enormous gravity well, but also because that life is likely to be oceanic. It would be a sad solution to the Fermi paradox indeed, if life in the universe is common, but civilizations that can leave their planets are rare, no matter how intelligent they are. Stay tuned for more updates on this exoplanet as they become available. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently eyeing the James Webb Space Telescope suspiciously as it eyes K2-18b suspiciously. That's what it does. It eyes the universe suspiciously and is finding the universe's dirty laundry and skeletons in the closet. Fully formed galaxies at the beginning of the universe that should not be, exoplanets with potential biosignatures and a cornucopia of other mysteries. Very questionable, that telescope. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.